Hello everyone. I'm happy to introduce Professor Egal Shochat from the Ben Gurion University of Negev. Egal is head and co-founder of construction management program at the Department of Structural Engineering. Just to let you know that this department accounts about 350 students in the bachelor, master's, and PhD programs. Egal completed his doctoral studies at the Technion, the Faculty of Civil Engineering, and before 2004 he was a faculty member of the Faculty of Civil Engineering at the Technion. Research interests are extreme event engineering and management, construction safety, performance-based maintenance, healthcare facilities management, and automation and robotics in buildings. Professor Shochat published more than 100 publications in scientific journals and in the international proceedings of the conferences. Please.
Thank you. אז הרצאה באנגלית או בעברית?
אנגלית.
אוקיי, אז תודה רגינה על נייס אינטרודקשן. As Regina told you, I'm from the Department of Structural Engineering in Ben-Gurion University. Our main research topic is preparedness of infrastructures and critical infrastructures to extreme events in general. And today I will talk particularly seismic events, earthquakes. And I will present in particular research that is going on now in my department on the examination of high risk vulnerable area, in this case Tiberias, which is located probably if you are geomarine department in the lake of on the shore of the lake, western shore of the Lake of Galilee, near north of here. And I will talk about two main aspects of this project, of this research, the geological aspect and the structural aspect of the resistance of the building to such event, a seismic event. In our model, we try to implement the software of HAZUS. HAZUS is a hazard, the United States. It's a risk management and risk assessment software that developed particularly for the US, but can be implemented worldwide. And it can be used for the various types of hazards, such as seismic, tsunami, landslides, floods, and so on. And in order to use it in the case of Israel, we need to make some adaptations of the behavior of the structures to different acceleration, ground accelerations. And the first part I will present will focus on this adaptation, on this I would say analysis that we are trying to adapt the fragility of the local building types to the model of to the hazard assessment model. In this in this software, we are trying to simulate events in order to make to prepare for such event. We are trying to map to create data of the infrastructures and other inhabited facilities, and we are trying to create scenarios for the given events. This is the introduction of the software, and this software is used worldwide, and it was proved as an effective tool. It is in use in the US for various types of events, and also in other areas such as South America and so on. The software is used for calculation of the damage in different polygons. We are using GIS. The software uses GIS files, which in these files the area is divided to multiple census tracts, polygons, and in each polygon we have the data on the different facilities, the different buildings, and by this and by creating a scenario with given ground acceleration and with the adaptation of the fragility of the buildings to this accelerations, we can assess the damage. And in the next stage, the last part of my presentation, I will present a risk management model that will use the data from this software. So we use this GIS file divided to polygons, and we the input we are using is ground accelerations calculated according to the events, and by this we expect to assess the number of casualty in terms of death and injuries, the physical damage to structures and infrastructures, and the additional damage, indirect damages such as effect on hazardous materials, fires, and so on. And in our risk model, we intend to accumulate all these consequences into economic means. We chose Tiberias in the north of Israel because it is located in a high-risk area in terms of seismic parameters. It is along the Dead Sea Fault, which is along the African Syrian Fault, and according to previous studies, the area is prone to multiple risks because of some active and some of them not active faults in the area. Here we see different faults in the area of Tiberias. The city, as I mentioned, is located on the west shore of the Lake of Galilee, and here in blue you can see different active or suspiciously active faults in this area according to the previous studies. Here you see events, seismic events in the last year in this region, especially in the north northwest part of the lake. Those of you who were here last year probably heard about this slight earthquakes in the area of Tiberias. Though they were not major but minor, you see the intensity of the events. our methodology include data gathering on the intensity, location, and depth of the events, translating them to ground acceleration, and then using this in a combined data that includes critical infrastructures, structures, the demography, and risks, maps for risks such as landslides, hazards. By using acceleration, the ground acceleration, and considering all these aspects, we expect to produce output that will include damage to critical infrastructures, to structures, the demography, and the risks of landslide. And finally, we will create an economic means, economic measurement of the risk of such event in this area. In order to do this, we need to adapt the hazards model to the Israeli condition, to the local construction types. And what we need to do is to make to adapt the fragility curves of the behavior of the structures. This includes static analysis, and then transferring the curves into curves of spectral translation of and spectral acceleration, and express it in terms of damage levels and fragility curves. So this is the scheme of our model. We are implementing a force, and then translating this force into the actual force on each floor in the building. This translated to shear forces and to displacement, and from this we can translate it to the damage level in the building. And this is converted to a displacement and expression of the shear forces as against the displacement that we saw in the last part of the previous slide. And this can give us the point where the building will collapse, or will the damage will be complete damage. Most of the casualty and most of the damage is caused at this point when the building is completely collapsed. This graph shows the capacity and the demand, and at this point we expect the building to classify the building damages to four. Actually, there are five, because here there should be no damage. There is a possibility. So there are five, but actually damaged structures can be complete collapse, or extensive, or moderate, or slight, where most of the damage is damage to most of the risk for the occupants of the buildings is caused by complete collapse. Serious part of the economic is considered also under the extensive damage category. So we are mostly interested in these two categories of damage. Here are the definition of the damage level, and we classify them according, of course, to the spectral displacements, and we translated the curve into according to the displacement to the categories of damage. And by doing this, we can adapt the hazards, the American software, to the local building practice. Here you can see fragility curves with four categories of damage complete, from slight to complete, and this allows us to classify the buildings after the simulation. These graphs are produced using the accumulated log normal probability function, where we use the value of the median value of the spectral displacement for a given damage state. Here you can see fragility curves between level between the value of 0 and 1 according to the peak ground displacement, the displacement of the ground. It can be expressed in two terms, displacement velocity, three times velocity or acceleration, and it depends on the types of data that we intend to use in the damage assessment model. In addition, we classify the buildings according to structural parameters, the structural system, mainly the height of the buildings, and parameters of seismic design, and also the occupancy of the buildings according to residential, commercial, industrial, and so on. This is the simplification of the GIS map of the city of Tiberias. There are here 12 census tracts. Each polygon is a census tract. In this polygon, we have a defined number of structures. We have the geology in the geological data for each polygon. And once we adapt, we insert the correct data of the buildings into each polygon, and we have the peak ground displacement or acceleration for a given event, we can have as an input of the simulation the damage state and also assessment of the casualty in terms of mortality and injury in different levels. This is a picture of one part of one census tract of the city. You see that most of the buildings are low-rise, and most of the structures are relatively old, with design not according to the state of the art, the actual seismic design. So that's why the city is vulnerable to such events. That's why we selected focus this research in this city. As I mentioned, the result of this mapping, most of the buildings are private, low-rise buildings. There are low-rise buildings with 3 to 5 floors height, and without columns flow, and also low-rise buildings with open column flow, which is a highly vulnerable building because of the low resistance of such a building to horizontal or lateral forces. There are also some 3 to 7 stories buildings without soft floor, soft first floor, and some with such soft floor, which are highly vulnerable to such event. Here you can see an example of a 3 or 4 story building with an open first floor. This floor is very vulnerable because of its very low resistance to lateral forces. Once a lateral force, for example, will be implemented, for example, from this side, or this structure can easily be translated in the direction of this lateral force, and we can receive relatively large displacement, and this may cause extensive damage or even complete collapse. Here another example this is, by the way, is a very, very local invention. You will not find so many structures like this elsewhere. And in terms of in the context of the local seismic risk, it is not very wise. And what the result of this research definitely will recommend to upgrade or to retrofit these buildings. So we make adaptation of the software, and this is the pie chart of the distribution of the buildings according to age. You see that most of the buildings are very old, before 64, more than 50%, and the rest of them also significant share before 74, and also before 84. This is the break-even point, because from this year there was a seismic engineering standard that we started to implement seismic standards from this year, a low code, and from this year a middle code, and from this year a high code. So all of these structures are highly vulnerable unless they are low rise, and these buildings are less vulnerable. We implemented several scenarios. Here we see the name of the fault that we use. This is the magnitude of the event that we attributed to each fault. This is the distance from the center of the city and the depth of the epicenter. And we, in our analysis, of course, considered the location of the fault, local amplification, and the side effects. We made, of course, adaptation according to the building stock, the demography, and all the parameters that are needed to assess the damage and the consequences of each event. This is an example of a scenario of a Jordan fault with a magnitude of 7. And this is distribution of the damage state of different buildings according to the four damage categories we saw before. We can see that we expect a significant part of the buildings to be completely collapsed, 165, and 65. Some buildings with extensive and moderate damage. So for such event, it is not negligible. This is another event, the same event, but here we consider the debris generation, which is another aspect, environmental aspect of such an event. The environment is going to be affected seriously as well, and this is the quantity of debris that will have to be handled after the event. Here a number of households that need shelter after an event, and look at the number. The number of people, 8,400, which is about 2,000 households that need shelter. I will now go. Do you have questions up to this point?
Any questions?
Do you want to raise questions?
So any questions, please? So I have a question. Sorry?
Yeah, please.
How you divide for the city for the sectors based on the kind of the buildings or based
The census tract is a statistical. It's a statistical map. Actually, when you intend to make to carry out a GIS analysis, you can purchase a GIS map of each area in the city, in the country, each city, and each city is statistically divided. The census tracts are divided according to the number of people in each census tract. It is done for statistical analysis. And actually, what you have seen is a structural, statistical, combined structural, statistical, stochastical analysis. So this is done actually by the Central Bureau of Statistics. You buy it and of course you can change it, but there is no reason to do it.
Okay, and just another question then you ask.
Yeah.
So a question is for the building is cold, so the ground floor. So the initial reason was to just to open the space without any relation to the probable earthquakes. So what was the reason to build such constructions?
This is a common
yes
common construction practice in Israel. Probably if you go around the country, if you are Israelis, of course you know. This open ground floor, it is done because of sometimes economic reasons and to save. Of course, this structure is much cheaper or much less if you close it and if you make this frame more rigid. If you make this frame more rigid by adding here, for example, a beam, and you close this, of course it costs much more. It's a way of architects and contractors to save money, actually. But in terms of seismic resistance, it's not good. And normally, when such buildings will have to be retrofitted by adding here a lower beam, a beam below the floor here, and perhaps also close this the gap between these columns, each two columns.
Okay, thank you.
This is a big one of the major hazards in this city, of course, and one of the in the next. Part of my presentation, I will talk about how to upgrade the existing structures. Yeah.
I wanted to ask something about you
the model takes into consideration ground acceleration. Does it take, or is there a possibility to take into consideration the location of the building in comparison to a specific fault? Because we know that if it's an unfault, if the faults are running through the city.
Yeah, it's not so precise. Actually, the software takes all the buildings in the census tracts, put them in the center of the census tract, and statistically determine the damage. It's not so precise as you describe.
So it takes the worst case scenario.
I would say yes, okay. yes. But you know the precision or the resolution of this risk model is at the order of 10, 20, 30%. So taking them and placing them in different places will not make a significant difference. You will see in the next stage when we translate these results to an alternative seismic retrofit, the benefit to cost ratio, the break-even point, is very clear cut. So there is no need to make it's very time consuming and in terms of also simulation and modeling to do what you suggest. Okay, good. Thank you for the question. Now I will go to a second part of my talk. It's as you can see, perhaps you noticed the first part, you could see the GSI, the Geological Survey Institute in Jerusalem. We collaborate in our department with many academic institutions. In this project, we have the GSI in Jerusalem, and we collaborate with the Department of Emergency Medicine in Ben Gurion University, in my university, and also with with the University of Maryland in the United States, the project management. Actually, the student who led this, who participated in this, is a joint student in Maryland and also in Ben Gurion University. So this is a joint effort, and I find a lot of benefits from such efforts. In this part, I will present you the risk management model, and as a result as I mentioned before, the history of the region. Even though we talk a lot about seismic risk in Israel is not high seismicity area. As you will see, it's a relatively low seismicity area, actually. However, the seismic risks are not low because of the high vulnerability of the structures, as we saw before, and of the population, because we are not used to seismic events, as for example in Chile, where they have maybe every 2 weeks they have a seismic event, or in California, where they have at least once in 100 years a major seismic event. So it's a not high seismicity area, but vulnerable, maybe highly vulnerable in case of such event. The issues we are facing in terms of because of seismic risk in residential building is that 810,000 homes in Israel were not designed according to high seismic code. This is the main problem. And the National Master Plan 38, which was initiated by the government of Israel, actually has been literally failed because it is based on an economic drive the government does not subsidize this program. The government expects that the market will act because of economic drivers, and actually economic drivers in areas such as Tiberias do not exist. They exist in Tel Aviv or in the center of the country, and this is the areas where the this master plan is implemented. Yes, please.
I think that the place that needs it more is, for example, the Beit She'an area. Nothing is really happening there because the socioeconomic profile of the people and the economic forces are not concerned about
It's a problem because the government thinks economically, and the government cannot leave all the problems to be solved by the...
But it's a decision. They can change this.
It's a there are an election in 2 months. Maybe the people can consider maybe other strategies to face this. But Master Plan 38 is not a solution, even though this is the formal solution or by considered the formal solution by the government. As I mentioned, we are we developing this phase of the work, the research and risk management. It includes the risk assessment that you just saw with the output of the casualty loss and the economic losses. And we take this to the risk mitigation, where we translate the damage in terms of casualty and physical and economic damage to avoidance of the damage or reduction, mitigation, or transferring the some of the risk by sharing the risk with, for example, insurance companies. And alternatives like this. I will not present all the possibilities that we. I will focus in this presentation with avoidance and reduction, not with transferring and retention of the building of the risk. And the criteria is, as I mentioned, the benefit to cost analysis. Based on economic means, we will try to show that the risk, the reduction of risk as a result of a retrofit strategy worth the investment in such a retrofit. Our model includes the stochastic event, as I mentioned before, the hazard analysis and the vulnerability of the structures and the population, and from the loss analysis, we intend to create a financial expression of the losses. This is a historical review of seismic events in the last 2,000 years, and as you can see, intensity of events here, the events are classified to very strong events and medium or moderate events. You can see that the return period of events is sometimes we have here 300 to 400 years without events. Sometimes we have a series of very strong events and some moderate events. You can see that if we are looking at a period, a span of 2,000 years, we have here 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11 events, very strong and strong over more than 2,000 years. So the average return period is more than 200 years. We take the building inventory, as you saw before, and create a building taxonomy according to the different structures. And so we classify them and consider the site conditions to hazard analysis with different events in different type of soil. In this area, there are some spots of soft soil where we expect liquefaction of soil, which may create landslides, and we considered this in this analysis. This is again the polygon of the polygons in the city, and here taxonomy of the building according to the height and the time of construction, and you see that most of the buildings are low rise and quite old, and from these buildings we expect some of the or significant part of the risk. This is the site condition amplification because of soft soil, and in this area there are some as I mentioned, the spots of this type of ground that we conditioned, we analyzed. So the ground surface, as I mentioned, we consider the amplification, liquefaction, and landslide as a result of this. All of these are the side effects that we are interested. The distance and the local geology and the magnitude, of course, of the event. All of these are in the site conditions that we create in the model. Of course, we took the capacity and the demand with the fragility curves and the different damage state, as I mentioned before. And these are these results, you know. I want to go to the results of the building damage. Here, the building damage for concrete frames and reinforced masonry building wall. These are very very soft, low-rise buildings. And you can see here that, for example, in this scenario, let's see the Jordan 7 that we saw before, 95% of the URM buildings are expected to be damaged in different levels of damage, and 77% of the concrete frames buildings are expected. This is scenario. In this scenario, we can see here that out of this 95%, here the according to built here, the old building from the old building constructed before 80, 64% are expected to be completely damaged, collapsed, or completely obsolete, or extensively damaged. This is the same for the same scenario, the casualty. If we look at the URM, 84% will survive, where 50% or 16% will be harmed, maybe death or injured. The exact result is. Was used in the analysis, in the economic analysis. According to BTL, again, you see that the old buildings in this scenario, the scenario that we saw before, we can see that the severity 4 is the severity of injury, severity 4 is death. This is seriously injured, and this is slightly injured. These two categories considered very, very in economic means considered very severe. Normally, people who are seriously injured in the risk analysis will cost more than a case of a dead person because of the long period of healthcare that we need to take in consideration. So in our model, a death case equal to $1 million according to the local income, the average local income, and the residual life expectancy of such a case. And in case of seriously injured, the value of the injured is more than this, approximately $1.5 million. So here is a benefit to cost analysis. This is for another scenario, the six German six scenario, and this is a benefit benefit to cost analysis. Losses avoided in terms of million dollars in case that we retrofit the vulnerable buildings, mainly the buildings that we saw with the soft ground floor and sometimes the soft brick walls. What we can see here that if we take the building that constructed before 1980 and we retrofit them, the benefit to cost ratio is 1.1. It means that this investment is economic. The benefit to cost ratio is an economic means that divide the benefits as a result of such a project by the cost. And the cost are the investment that we need to invest in such a project. And the URN, the building URN are the low-rise buildings, unreinforced masonry buildings. Retrofitting them as the BCR of 1.3. We can see the life saved, the expectancy of life saved along the design planning horizon. This is significant. So if we look at an economic point of view, there is a sense, a serious sense, to invest in the reinforcement or retrofitting, seismic retrofitting of the old buildings in this city. And actually, at the present, the policy of the government does not succeed in this. And what we suggest in this research, what we are going to suggest, the research is going to be concluded in a few months, is to set up a new government policy for reinforcement or retrofitting of a building in areas mainly, as mentioned before, like Beit She'an, Kiryat Shmona, Tiberias, and this area need to be, and also Haifa. Haifa is another area which is highly vulnerable because of the Yagur fault, which is very close to where we are sitting now.
Can I?
That's it. This concludes my my talk. I hope I created some interest in this subject, and let me have your questions.
Thank you very much, Igor. Any question, please?
Yeah.
You did a cost analysis for each scenario, but if all the scenarios are probable, how do you do a cost analysis for?
To accumulate all the scenarios together. That's a big issue, the scenarios that you consider. If you take all the scenarios together, probably the accumulated effect will increase the attractiveness of each seismic retrofit. So no doubt that if we accumulate them together, retrofitting the URM buildings constructed before 1980 is definitely needed and desperately needed, I think. If we combine them together, sure. Okay. Of course, we will refer to this in the final report of this research. If you are interested, by the way, we are in the process of publishing now some papers on this project. If you want to see some of the results, let me have your contact and I will send you. Some of them are I have now two under review, but probably will be published next year.
Okay, ask a question, please. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.